Well, welcome everybody. My name is Emily Mattson, and I will be moderating the discussion today. This is Ian Johnson, author of Sparks, China's Underground Historians and Their Battle for the Future. He is also the author of several other fantastic books, including The Souls of China, The Return of Religion After Mao, Wild Grass, Three Stories of Change in Modern China, and A Mosque in Munich, Nazis, the CIA, and the Rise of the Muslim Brotherhood in the West. Johnson is an expert on Chinese politics, society, and religion. He has lived for, I believe, over 20 years in China.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, wow. He is a contributor to the Council of Foreign Relations blog Asia Unbound, and he is currently, since 2021, he is a Stephen A. Schwartzman Senior Fellow for China Studies at CFR. Johnson has not only lived for more than 20 years in China, he's been engaged with China for the past 35 years. He's well known for reporting on grassroots China, and his work has been recognized by the National Endowment for the Humanities. He won a Pulitzer Prize for his reporting on China. He won Stanford University's Shorenstein Prize, a grant from Open Society Foundation, a Nieman Fellowship at Harvard University, the American Academy of Religions Award for Best In-Depth News Writing, and the Robert E. Silvers Foundation grant for Work in Progress. And he has spent many years working as a news correspondent in China, starting for Baltimore's The Sun and The Wall Street Journal. And he has also reported extensively for the New York Times and written for them and the New York Review of Books. And he's also done extensive work in Germany, including reporting on the fall of the Berlin Wall and German unification in the late 80s and early 90s. And he's also contributed multiple book chapters recently to Forbidden City, the Palace at the Heart of Chinese Culture, and the Oxford Illustrated History of Modern China. So Ian Johnson, welcome to Georgetown. Thank you so much for coming here to chat about your new book.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me. My apologies for being late. This is the second experience I've had with Amtrak being late, and I think Amtrak gives authoritarianism a good name. Just bring in China Rail, please, to fix the system here on the East Coast, at least. So I'm going to be talking about my new book. It's been a project that I've been working on for almost the past 10 years. I started this project in the early 2010s. I was in China in the 1990s as a correspondent, as you mentioned, and then I went back around the time of the Olympics, the Summer Olympics in 08, and I went there to work on a book on religion, which I later did write, The Souls of China, about the religious revival, sort of a grassroots look at different faith groups in China in among Han Chinese. But at the same time, I was interested in sort of getting the pulse of the country, and so I began interviewing public intellectuals in China. And it turned into this 30-part series for the New York Review of Books, which you can still find on their website, called Talking About China. So over the course of doing these interviews, this is over a decade, right? So it wasn't like I was interviewing everybody over the course of, you know, like a week or two. It was a few of these interviews every year. And this issue of history kept coming back over and over again as a key point to understanding China and what was, I mean, obviously we had to know history is important in every country and history is very important in China with long continuous civilization, but the control of history, especially over the past 75 years, is being a crucial point for getting what's going on in China. So began the series in 2010, and fortuitously or not, the first person I interviewed was Yang Jisheng, who was a Xinhua reporter and later wrote several books of history, including sort of a definitive history of the Great Famine called Tombstone. And by talking to these people, I began to realize that this was another important issue. And so starting about 2014, so in the Xi Jinping era, I started to do what I normally do when I write these kinds of books, which is to follow people around, with their permission, obviously. I'm not the secret police following, not that kind of following around, but you know, to immersively spend time with them, especially as they do field work, as they do their work, and get a picture of how they operate, why they operate. The book is called the China's Underground Historians and Their Battle for the Future. Maybe I'll start by explaining what I mean by underground historians. And I'll start this slideshow, which is timed. It's not timed to parallel everything I'm saying. It's just meant to have some pictures running in the background of places of memory in China. The first dozen or so pictures are from this one particular county. I went there with a magnum photographer who, coincidentally or not, is my wife, who works now, is an artist and does work on memory. And so she took portraits of sort of landscape of memory, pictures of places of memory in the area of Dao County, Daoxian, in southern Hunan province. And later there'll be some portraits of some of the main characters in the book. So I'll just trip this going, and I think it's sort of, so there's nothing particularly relevant with what I'm saying now with this picture. We can just kind of look at it. You know, if you get bored with what I'm saying, you can take a look at these pictures floating by, because they're probably of a higher quality than my talk. But I think, you know, underground historians, what do I mean by that? I mean people, some of them are trained historians with PhDs in history, and they write what I would call modern-day samizdat publications that are, they make PDF publications of history. They're researched with footnotes and stuff like that. But you have other people who are more autodidactic, who have decided they want to record something, often tripped from a personal, caused by a personal event that they experienced. And they decided that they wanted to record. They make video documentaries. And so I use this as a general term for all of these kinds of people. Even though not all of them are formal historians, they are creating historical knowledge by putting things on the record, by doing oral history work and stuff like that. And I think maybe one way to describe who they are and what their motivations are is if I read a page from the book. And this describes a turning point in the life of this one person named Tan He Cheng, who worked in this area of southern Hunan province in Dao County. He spent 30 years documenting a massacre of 9,000 people in the Cultural Revolution, one of an estimated 100 similar massacres that took place in the countryside and which have not been part of mainstream accounts of the Cultural Revolution, which most accounts mainly focus on urban areas and educated people, professors, etc. like that. So maybe I'll just read a bit about his life and what got him going, and that might give us a bit of a flavor of the book perhaps, and then also some of their motivations. When Tan He Cheng graduated from college in the 1980s, graduates were assigned jobs, and he was sent to a factory. He had a knack for what was then known as baogao wenxue, or reportage literature, a kind of nonfiction that used real-life stories to make social criticism. He won a prize and drew the attention of the editors at Furong, or Hibiscus, a Changsha literary magazine looking for new talent. His new job coincided with an effort by the party's reformist leader at the time, the general secretary Hu Yaobang, to account for the past. Besides rehabilitating millions of unjustly accused people, Hu decided in 1986 to send 1,300 officials to Dao County to investigate the killings that had taken place there. Their findings that 9,093 people had been killed, including 4,519 in Dao County. Most shocking, 15,000 people were involved in the killings, mostly government officials. In fact, 37% of all local Communist Party members had participated in the killings. Tan was seen as a reliable writer. He had enthusiastically supported Deng Xiaoping's reform policies. He was no different than others. He had been rehabilitated. And because of the media in China is state controlled, his presence wasn't unusual. He joined the team and went down with them to Dao County. People spoke openly to him about the events. He had complete access to tens of thousands of pages of documents that the officials unearthed. But by the end of 1986, the political tide had turned against accounting for the past. He told me, "When the first round of interviews was over, the political atmosphere was already darkening. Forces in the party opposed what was called bourgeois liberalization. So my articles couldn't be published. And the more time went on, the more impossible it became. it got tighter and tighter. The smart thing to do would have been to drop the project. Tan had a family and needed to think of them. But something about Dow County wouldn't let him rest. He was meant to portray the massacre as a mistake, a few bad apples who had let things get out of control, which is the way the party usually explains its mistakes. If he had been allowed to publish some of his findings, maybe this is what he would have written. But now that he couldn't publish anything, he was freed of this need to compromise and was faced with a stark choice: drop it or pursue it fully. He chose the latter because of one horrible realization. Not one of the roughly 9,000 people killed had been planning a counter-revolutionary event. It wasn't that some had been killed unjustly. All of them had. When I understood this, he said, I was heartbroken. I began to realize that the party had a history of violence. Already in 1928, it organized violent peasant revolts that killed masses of people. And land reform, shortly after the party took power in 1949, was incredibly violent. It was one mass killing after another. All of a sudden, it became clear. There was no justification for what happened. That was when Tan felt his calling. He thought of the survivors, the family members, and the reform-minded officials who had given him information. He had pledged to them that he wasn't going to do this for personal gain, but for their and for all Chinese people's descendants, so that this kind of state-led violence would not happen again. He went back to his editors. They were nice people. One suggested he wait 20 or 30 years. Maybe around 2000 or 2010, it would be possible to publish it. He told Tan, never imagining that things would be even tougher later on. Tan thanked him, but it was clear that he didn't agree. Word began to get around that he was traveling down to Dow County on his own to do follow-up interviews. By then, Tan had been identified as a troublemaker. He wasn't fired, but was marginalized. Promotions, conferences, prizes never came his way, but he didn't care. You know, he said, I can kiss ass as well as anyone. I'm really good at it. In fact, I'm an excellent ass kisser. I can tell people what they want to hear, and I can write an article any way you want it. But I have a minimum moral standard. I can't turn black into white. So when they said they wouldn't publish it, I thought, okay, that's your problem. But my life had changed, and so I thought, this is it. One way or another, I will publish this. So he's a good example of these kind of underground historians, because they're not what I would call dissidents in the sense that they don't have a program to change the government. They're not necessarily outside the system entirely. He kept his job. He bought an apartment. His daughter went to college. He still lives in China. And other people who I profile are like that also. The two main characters, one of them is a feminist scholar in Guangzhou, who later made 20-odd documentary films, Ai Xiaoming. She's also maybe a little more on the margins, but she kept her job and gets a pension from the state and so on and so forth. But they all feel a calling or a need to address this whitewashing of history that the party has engaged in. Talking to this audience may not be necessary to actually absolutely explain why history matters. But it matters, of course, in every country. It matters in this country. We're still debating events of the 17th century, such as the centrality of slavery to the founding of the United States. Our newspaper headlines are filled with events from the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, such as the effects of them, such as the civil rights movement, affirmative action, abortion rights. We don't consider this to be ancient history that doesn't concern us or doesn't matter. And by the same token, these things, even though some of them are from last century, some of them are from just last year, the COVID crackdowns and so on, they still matter to a lot of people. And they matter especially to how the party frames its rule. Because the party legitimizes itself in two ways. They're kind of related. Essentially, it legitimizes its rule through history. By the party's telling of history is that China was laid low in the 19th century, the Opium Wars, etc. And there were well-meaning patriots in the 19th century, in the first half of the 20th century, but it was only the Communist Party that could save China and lead it on the path to prosperity. And there are certainly elements of truth to that. But its continued rule is also based on sort of performance legitimacy, that because the party has basically a relatively unblemished record with a few hiccups here and there, it should be able to rule China into the future without having to stand for election or anything like that. So the history of the past 75 years matters a lot, and the efforts by these people to complicate the historical picture that's presented in China isn't meant to directly undermine party rule. It's not like they're out to say, aha, we wish to overthrow the Communist Party. But it's meant to introduce more nuances into this kind of whitewashed view of history. I think also one thing that interests me is that they feel in some ways it's their patriotic duty to do this. I remember one editor of a history journal called Remembrance, GE, which has been publishing for 15 years, underground, unofficial, just PDFs. He told me, mainly they focus on the Cultural Revolution. And he said, you know, it can't be that all historical research on the Cultural Revolution is done at Western universities. He knew people like Rod McFarquhar at Harvard or Michael Schoenhals at Lund University. He said, I love all those people and we're good friends, but it can't be that they're the only one telling China's story. It has to be that we have people in our country writing on the Great Famine, the Cultural Revolution, and et cetera, et cetera. So it's kind of an interesting twist, I think. I think also these people do have a very long game. They're not intending to change things in China now. They have different motivations. Some of them are viewing their work as kind of messages in a bottle for future generations of Chinese people when it's more available, when it's more possible to talk about this in China. But they also think that it matters today. I don't want to listen to a total lecture. Maybe I just explain also the name Sparks. It comes from this magazine Spark, Xinghuo. And Spark was a magazine started in 1960 by students from Lanzhou University who had been exiled to a remote part of China in the middle of the Great Famine. And they saw the Great Famine taking place. And like a lot of people, they thought, if only top leaders knew about this, they would fix the problem. So they had this quixotic idea of starting a journal. They got a hold of a mimeograph machine, and they made two issues and printed it and sent out copies to party officials around China. The essays themselves are really interesting because they get at the heart of one party rule. They're on authoritarianism, the problem of no checks and balances, of lack of freedom of expression, of farmers not owning their land, which is still an issue today, that all land is owned by the state. And they wrote this, but of course, as you can imagine, very quickly they were rolled up. The state stopped this. They were thrown in jail. The 43 people were arrested. Three of them were ultimately executed. Most of them got a dozen or 15 years in labor camps. But after the Cultural Revolution, one of them especially, this woman named Tan Qianshui, Ms. Tan, was able to look into her personal file, her dang'an, and in her personal file, as you can imagine in a very effective, efficient bureaucratic state, there was everything, including her love letters to her boyfriend, one of the three people who had been shot, all the issues of Spark, because of course the government had confiscated all the issues and they hadn't published tens of thousands of copies or something. You can't get copies of it in a research library. But she could make photos of everything in her file. So she took photos of all of this stuff, the confessions of all the people involved, all the police records. And in the 1990s, it just sort of sat around in her apartment. And then something happened that we take completely for granted now, and that is digital technology, basic digital technology. Not social media, not the internet per se, but things like PDFs. And people, her friends and her they created PDFs of this and began to circulate it to other people by email and by USB sticks and just say, hey, take a look at this. And the effect on many people was sort of shocking. It was transforming. The Beijing-based critic and translator of Vaclav Havel, Cui Weiping, she said, now we have our genealogy. Now we have our lineage. We know that people in as early as 1960, just 10 years after the founding of the PRC, are grappling with the same issues as today. Lack of checks and balances, lack of freedom of expression. Mm-hmm. And so it became a touchstone for this movement. There's a great documentary film made about it by the director Hu Jia. And it's symbolic, I think, of the power of this simple technology to create what I think is a kind of small-scale collective memory among public intellectuals in China about what happened in previous decades in a way that wasn't really possible in the past, when the best you could do was hand around a photocopy to somebody. Of course, now, if you're really on the government's blacklist, they can stop your internet connection, they can prevent you from sending an email. But I'm not talking about 100 high-profile dissidents. I'm thinking of thousands and thousands of public intellectuals around China in big and small cities who are aware of these issues. I think that that's sort of another point that's worth getting into, perhaps. So maybe with that, I'll just stop my introduction and we can talk and open it up to have
Thank
a discussion.
Thank you very much, Ian. One thing I was curious about was, so how did you find the subjects for your book? How did you get in touch with them? Was it in your years doing journalistic coverage in China, or can you talk a little more about that?
I was doing this Q&A series for the New York Review of Books. Mm. That's what got me going. And then once you start talking to people, everybody says, well, you have to talk to this person. Once you talk to more and more people, you realize who are the most important people in this movement. And it just sort of snowballed after that. In fact, the issue more was how to focus on a few representative cases. And of course, one issue is always a prime directive, I think, when you're doing any kind of field research like this, especially, say, journalistic work on a sensitive subject, is do no harm. And so you always ask people for their permission. Are they okay going on the record? Do they want to be off the record? Do they not want to talk to you at all or just give you some background information? All of those things are fine. And because I did it over a long period of time, there wasn't any pressure. I wasn't on this deadline. I quit daily journalism in 2010 specifically to write books, so I didn't have to be on this clock that journalists are always on.
So that leads me to my next question, which is, with the publication of your book, are you concerned at all over the book bringing unwarranted or unwanted attention to some of these people you interviewed?
No, again, I think overwhelmingly the response by people, of course I talked about it with them ahead of time, has been positive. They're happy that somebody's writing about it. And some people who worried about that, I just didn't put in the book. So there was no shortage of material. And maybe it's worth mentioning, in an academic setting, especially in the social sciences, there's a tendency to anonymize people if you're doing ethnographic work. And while I understand the impulse for that, I think there's a degree of paternalism and sometimes condescension in that if you ask somebody and you're talking to an educated person who's well aware of the consequences, if they want to go on the record, then I think they should go on the record. Many of these people, they don't want to be anonymized, right? They want their story to be told. They want people to know about this. They're proud of their work. And I think that this idea that people are kind of too stupid to figure it out, and we're not talking about, when I was a journalist in the 1990s, I go interview farmers in the countryside. What do you think of Jiang Zemin or this? And the guy would say, here's my Shenfenzheng, here's my ID card. Take a picture of that and put it in the newspaper and you tell Jiang Zemin what I think. And then you're kind of like, okay, maybe we won't do it exactly like that. Maybe we'll just anonymize you because you don't quite understand the consequences, right? But the two main characters of my book, Ai Xiaoming, she's a university professor who's made tons and tons of films. She's really smart. Zhang Xue, also a university graduate. She's made tons of films and written many, many articles and has been harassed by police. She knows what's at stake. So I don't feel, I think they're okay with it.
Yeah, fair enough. Thank you. I'm a historian and I work a lot on historical memory too. So I was wondering if during the many years that you were reporting in China, if you noticed any kind of changes in the party's legitimizing narrative, say from the 1980s through, the 2020s.
Yeah, I talk about that a bit. I have, starting for example, the party has had three major historical resolutions on history. Mm. And these are overarching framing resolutions that are then sent down to the localities to explain how history should be interpreted. One was issued in 1945 by Mao, essentially, explaining why he took control of the party and his theories and ideas. One was in 1981, presided over by Deng Xiaoping, which explained why the debacles of the Mao era happened and why he was in control. And one was in 2021 by Xi Jinping, which was explaining why he was in control and why he was in his view of history. So these things happen every 40 or so years at major turning points. You know, when the 1981 resolution took place, there were still a lot of people who remembered the Great Famine of 1959 to 1961. Mao came in for a lot of criticism. They had a lot of, this wasn't just, you know, 10 people in a room writing this resolution. They had thousands of officials come to Beijing, stay in hotels. They had big conferences and discussions. And they wanted to criticize Mao much more strongly. But Deng had this realization that if we go too hard after Mao, there's no other founding father of the country. So unlike de-Stalinization, when you had Lenin, who could be kept intact as the founding father of the Soviet Union, if you criticize Mao too heavily, you get to the heart of, you know, who essentially founded the party. Well, he didn't quite found the party, but who led it for so long and founded the PRC. So they toned down the criticism of Mao. And one interesting thing to me is that, you know, sometimes if in some societies, when history recedes into the background, you can sometimes you can talk about it more forthrightly and more clearly, and you can criticize things. Like now, we don't shy away from saying that what happened to Native American Indians is genocide. I think a lot of people would agree with that formulation, even if it's a jarring word. I mean, it's not too much to say that. And that wouldn't have been possible, say, 100 years ago, or even 50 years ago. People would have thought you're a bit of an extremist if you used that term, right? But now it's pretty much in the mainstream discourse. But in an authoritarian state like China, history, as it goes back, it gets elided and almost smoothed over more and more. So the 2021 resolution on party history has even less on the Cultural Revolution. It doesn't have more. It's not like, well, the Cultural Revolution is even further in the pack. We can talk about it more freely. It's that we just want to make it even more and more perfect. So there's this kind of seamless story that's been told about the party going from strength to strength. And that's, I think, Xi Jinping, that is part of his agenda. That's one of his signature policies. When he took power in 2012, his first public appearance with the Standing Committee of the Politburo was in the permanent exhibition at the National Museum of China, The Road to Rejuvenation, which tells this story about how the party rescued China, basically. And in 2013, the next year, he basically forbid criticism of the Mao era by saying there are two sides of the same coin. You can't criticize one and support the other. So you can't say I'm against the Mao era, but I'm for the reform era. It's this kind of liang gefu ding, the two negations. You can't do that. So it's been a series of steps that he's taken. So it's clearly one of his top priorities.
Yeah, I was actually going to ask you about the Fuxing Zhilu exhibit. And have you visited? You wrote a chapter of your book on this museum, right? So what are your thoughts on how the Century of Humiliation, the War of Resistance against Japan, which also play a big role in the historical narrative of the party's rise to power and, you know, saving China, what do you think of that exhibition?
It's a great exhibition. If you ever go to Beijing, you have to go see it from an anthropological point of view, or you need to go and see that show, because it tells you in a neat, compact way how the party sees history, right? And again, it's not like it's all BS or something, but there are elements of the truth, right, that you can certainly see in there. It just, there's absolutely, though, the current edition has absolutely zero mention of the Cultural Revolution. It's not like one picture from the Cultural Revolution, let alone the Great Famine or other things like that. So it's kind of a success story exhibition. And then it was redone, in 2021, actually in 2022, I guess they started it in 2021, after the resolution, to show the new era, the Xi Jinping era. So it has, you know, halls on Xi Jinping's history and stuff like that.
Yeah, I visited the museum back in, I think it was 2017, so before the latest edition of it. But yeah, I was very struck by, I mean, it's very good curatorial practice, I believe. I was impressed by the museum, absolutely.
Yeah, it's interesting. Yeah. They've got a lot of interesting stuff, like the scaffold where one of the founders of the Communist Party was executed. I mean, they got the scaffold from the prison, you know. In fact, when the Red Army entered Beijing, was it in 1948 or was it, no, early 1949, right? When they entered Beijing, they sent out a team to get that scaffold because they wanted it from the prison, because they knew that was something they wanted to have for their museum. So that was like pretty clear early on.
Wow. So going onto a related topic regarding Chinese history, you talk some in your book about the links, like it's not just the CCP that has wanted to kind of rewrite the history of the past. It's like, you know, and dynasties like the Qing dynasty had a newer history of the Ming dynasty, for instance. And, you know, this is a practice that goes way, way back in Chinese history. So can you talk a little bit about the continuities between previous regimes and the current regime?
Yeah, he said he's not only them who wants to rewrite history. I was thinking Ron DeSantis wants to rewrite history.
This is also true in our country.
Certainly a lot of commonalities between the US and China. But we aren't quite there yet. This is sort of course, massively generalizing, but dynasties tended to write a macro history of the preceding dynasty. And this overarching story was that the other dynasty had its glory period and did many great things, but it fell into decline, and therefore, ergo, we had to sort of replace them. And that's our, and then the subsequent emperors were legitimized simply by hereditary principle. There wasn't a need to then say why the next emperor was, because he was the chosen son or whatever, or had killed his brothers or whatever, and he was the guy in charge. So it was all pretty clear. The KMT, the Nationalist Party, the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party, has often had a difficult time in dealing with the KMT period, because they did end the Qing. That was sort of the end of the Qing. Sun Yat-sen is still a revered figure in China. I was just back in China in May, and I went to his mausoleum in Nanjing, and it's still an amazing. It's funny, when you go into the mausoleum, you look up, and it's a giant KMT symbol, right? The giant sort of star, the white star on the blue background. You're like, oh my God, it's like the KMT flag. It's still sort of shocking. But they basically, the view was that then, in a shortened period of time, they became hopelessly corrupt and incompetent, and that's why we had to replace them.
Speaking of Sun Yat-sen, Sun Yat-sen's bust is right here in this building. Yeah, Sun Yat-sen plays an important role at Georgetown. But yeah, I was also wondering, speaking of Chinese history, you talk in your book about the Jianghu historians, the so-called rivers and lakes historians, and kind of that legacy is related to, you know, what's going on with these kind of underground historians today. Could you talk about that connection a little bit?
Yeah, that's how some of the people see themselves, as Jianghu. So this the rivers and lakes that are beyond the limits of Chinese civilization, sort of like Robin Hood in the forest, that these areas are where you have people who are standing up to standing against authority, maybe injustice, and they have codes of honor, codes of conduct. They're like sworn brother, and today I'd say, you know, also sisterhoods of alliances, and so they see themselves in that tradition. They know they're on the margins and that they're fighting what could be a hopeless battle, but they feel it's their honor. I mean, the reference points that people talk about are not Western concepts. These are people, by and large, who have not been educated in the West. The documentary filmmaker I mentioned, Ai Xiaoming, she spent 1 year at the University of the South in Tennessee as a visiting scholar in the 1990s. That had an impact on her life, but she was not educated there, and nobody else I write about has studied abroad, and they're not citing, you know, Habermas and the theory of public space or something like that. The concept that comes up over and over again is yi, you know, justice, righteousness, zheng yi. Like they just sort of one guy told me, this guy Lao Hu Miao, Tiger Temple is his name that he's taken, Zhang Shihe. He said, the one thing that gets me really angry is, I asked him, why do you do this? Why do you do this? And he kept saying, I don't really get all these theoretical questions. I can't explain why. He said, the thing that gets me, you know, pissed off is injustice. And I saw this happening, these kids, blah, blah, blah. And that's why I decided I had to record it. And so that's sort of an idea that they have. And I think it's a universal idea, right? It's probably something I'd venture in almost every civilization.
So somebody, I'll keep her name anonymous, but told me when I asked her like what she thought about the importance of history to China, she told me, Wang Zi Li Shi the Ren Min Shi Mei You Wei Lai De, like, you know, the people who forget their history don't have a future. So I was wondering if you saw that sentiment at all amongst the people you were talking to.
I think that this is an absolutely crucial idea that people worry that all this is being forgotten and that it's their calling to keep a record of it, even if it doesn't get a big public viewing now. I think that they got more of a public viewing in the 2000s when the internet was taking off and it hadn't yet been brought under control. But they continued on now, and I started my research in the Xi Jinping era, They keep working on this because they view it as intrinsically important. Mm. And I think also it's worth noting that a difference, I think, from earlier generations is that there's much more of a link between what they do and overseas groups than in the past. There used to be like exile groups when they went overseas or when they really were became irrelevant inside China. But now there's much more flow back and forth. For example, this magazine Remembrance that I mentioned, it's written by people inside China, but it's edited by Chinese grad students in Texas. So they do kind of like the back end work to it. So they help put it together, organize, and help email it back into China as well. It's a place where you can keep the articles and stuff safe in case somebody's computer gets grabbed or something like that. So we saw that also with the white paper protests last year. There was much more interplay. People, all of a sudden it was amazing like how many people had VPNs in China. In raw numbers, it's quite significant. In percentage of the population, it's really small. Mm. But in raw numbers, it's, I think, quite significant. Millions of people who were sending stuff like to Twitter accounts and using it almost like a clearinghouse and then repackaging it and sending it back into China. I think that interaction is something that's unique to the current trends.
And so you think technology has really helped with that?
It's helped. I mean, I don't want to do some Pollyannish technology thing, mm-hmm. because we know that technology is a huge power, a huge tool for the mm-hmm. government. There's a really good book written recently by a couple of journalists from the Wall Street Journal, Surveillance State, by Josh Chin and Liza Lin, and they chronicle, you know, all the things we know about surveillance cameras and da-da-da. But I think it's also worth mentioning that there are some digital resistance of the underclass, or whatever that you want to say.
And I was also wondering what the relationship is between, so there are a lot of Chinese academics who publish things that are not necessarily censored by the party. What is their role in all of this? Can this kind of history also, you know, move the needle in a different direction at all regarding overall viewpoints?
Well, I think it helps in some ways because the party can't completely ignore certain things from the past. So there, if you go to the Chinese version of Wikipedia, Baidu, Baike, there's an entry, for example, to Lin Zhao, who was one of the people I write about in the book a little bit. She was a contributor to this magazine, Spark. And they talk about the fact that she was executed and unjustly convicted, etc. So if you look, I think that because there's so much material out on her and so many people have published and circulated material about her that they can't completely credibly keep it down. I think where they do keep it down is more in social media. Mm. But if you're writing, you know, academics still have a hard time. I was just back in Beijing and I visited a friend of mine who was an editor of a anthropology journal, and he said that the censorship had been so tight that the past 3 years they had essentially, it was a quarterly, so they should have had 12 issues, but he could only get enough material together for one issue.
Oh, wow. That
essentially, the equivalent of the other 11 issues had been sort of censored, and they ended up having one issue on, you know, the anthropology of rock climbing or something like that, because it was sort of less, wasn't a sensitive topic. I think that still affected people. Mm-hmm. Yeah, now, I think a lot of people are viewing this as a long game.
Right.
Yeah. Not now.
It's interesting also to see what academic debates the party allows and which ones it doesn't. So I study China's World War II, and for a while there was this robust debate going on within China about, well, should the war start with the Mukden incident or the Marco Polo Bridge incident? And the party let that go on for several decades.
And also there's more recognition of the KMT's role.
There is indeed. Yeah, there is indeed. So going back to the title of your book, Ian, Sparks, I noticed that you chose to open your book with a quote from Hannah Arendt. Would you talk a little bit about the significance of that quote, kind of your viewpoint of kind of the meaningfulness of your work?
Yeah, well, the meaningful is not my work, but of their work, right? So
the
Hannah Arendt quote is, I could just paraphrase it, in the darkest of times, light tends to blind us. And any light is blinding. And we don't only later can we figure out whether it's just a candle or whether it's a blazing sun. In other words, whether it matters a lot or whether it doesn't matter a lot. And that only can come later. And I didn't choose this quote myself. It was at the beginning of an essay by one of the characters in the book, Zhang Xue, when she was writing about the rights lawyers she wrote about their efforts, and she used that quote. And so I thought it worked well. So it was. It seemed a bit odd to start a book on China with a quote by a Central European intellectual from the 20th century, but it wasn't me thinking of it, it was her thinking of it. And so that's why I used it.
Fantastic, and I think it's great that you ascribe, you make sure that these actors have all the agency in the world in your book. You know, you're exposing a lot of people to their voices as well outside of China, which I think is awesome.
Yeah, I hope this is
something. Yeah. Well, last question for you before we move into Q&A, Ian, is do you have any advice for people who are considering careers in journalism or who want to write about China? You know, that's a pretty huge question.
Well, one of the things that I find depressing now is how the numbers for people studying Chinese has gone down across the boards. I don't have the number at my fingertips, but it's gone down a lot. And I think this is such a pity. And it's, you know, for a variety of reasons, I think it kind of is a reflection perhaps of China's soft power or lack of it. In a way, there's many people motivated by K-pop and want to study Korean or manga and want to study Japanese rather than China. And in some ways, I hope that this book ends with a conclusion, with sort of a challenge to civil society in the West, in part, to do more to make these people known in the West. It sort of surprises me that no major film festival has done a retrospective of Ai Xiaoming's work or Hu Jie's work. And publishers nowadays just don't pay for translations the way they used to, at least. Many of the people from Central and Eastern Europe, intellectuals who were well-known, almost household names in the 60s, 70s, 80s in the West, I don't think they'd be public and they'd be known today because they probably wouldn't have been translated, but publishers back then translated their works. But the Chinese writers are not translated that much. It often takes a foundation to make a donation to a publisher to pay for the translation work. For example, a fantastic novel by the Chinese writer Fang Fang. She's well known for her Wuhan diary that was translated into English and published by a major commercial press. But she's also written a book about the campaign against landlords in the early 1950s. It's called Soft Burial. And the UCLA professor, Michael Berry, who's translated a lot of work, he's got this translation, he's ready, he's locked and loaded. He can work on it, he's got permission, he's got the contract, he just has no publisher who will publish it. Because they don't want to pay for it. They think it won't sell. And you know, it might not sell hundreds of thousands or tens of thousands of copies, but it's so important to do this. And you know, what I think is important is not to see the people I write about as exotic beings on another planet, but as part of our intellectual discourse. That the techniques that they use, for example, there's a kind of a star academic at Columbia University, Sadia Hartman, who's written about the enslaved person's experiences. And because we have no memories of the people who were brought over to North America as slaves, we don't have memoirs of them, we don't exactly know what they were thinking on the ships. She came up with this idea of what she calls critical fabulation, which is to do all the research possible to get everything you can and then maybe use your imagination to make the final leap into somebody's head. And you know, she's been profiled in The New Yorker and all this stuff, sort of a big name. Fang Fang is doing the same thing, right? She spent a lot of time researching this, and she used the novel to tell something that for which there's very little historical record. So why not bring people like that over for panel discussions or something like that? One problem is language. Most of the people don't speak English, so I can understand that that's an issue. But we somehow have to get over that, and maybe AI will be the solution. I'm not sure. Anyway.
Well, on that note, thank you so much, Ian, for your discussion. And let's move into Q&A. Let's give Ian a round of applause, everybody. Does anyone have any questions for Ian? Yeah, I saw your hand.
Thank you very much. That was fascinating. I was wondering about, it sounds like most of these histories are in the framework of the party. You know, what about pre-party China? You know, the dynastic histories, etc. Is that in the discourse, or is it all just sort of history began when the party began?
Well, of course, everyone's aware of the history didn't start in 1949.
Yeah, of course, but
one of the people, the book is structured around major chapters, and in between the chapters are vignettes, which I write about. These are vignettes of maybe 2,500 words about a place of memory, or a using this concept for memory studies, theaters of memory, so about movies and books and stuff like that. One of them is the book by Gao Hua called How the Red Sun Rose, which has been translated into English. However, it's an enormous doorstopper of a book, so it's not exactly the kind of book you want to put on your bedside unless you want to go to sleep. But anyway, it's about the 1942 Yan'an rectification movement. And so it does start pre-1949, but it is concerned with the Communist Party. There are people working, of course, many people working on other dynasties and things like that. But one person I know who used to write about old Beijing, he wrote a lot of books about old Beijing and trying to save it and blah, blah, blah. He's now writing about the about the Yuan dynasty, because he thinks it's he can use that as a model for a more multicultural China or something like that, that he'd like to highlight or plead that there'd be more of that today. So maybe, in a way, he's also using history for his own. But I think that's more of the exception, perhaps. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Ian, for the talk and for coming here from New York. I have not read your book yet, so I'm not completely sure what historical period it's covering. It sounds like it's covering quite a lot of time. I was wondering if you could speak to, you wrote an article in Foreign Affairs also about the A4 movement, the white paper protests, including that, about how information is stored outside and then also gets sent back into China in periods of mobility when you're seeing movements mobilize. I was wondering if you, when writing this book, came across any similar information sharing between, or maybe even skills sharing between the Hong Kongers and mainlanders, because as we know, Hong Kong is going through something similar, where a lot of the history, even just recent history from 2020, is now being erased. A lot of databases are being erased by the government, but there has been a resurgence, or the diaspora community has been actually publishing research about Hong Kong from afar and trying to document that. Was there any sort of, did you come across any sort of skills sharing or best practices sharing between the mainland community and the Hong Kong community?
Mm. Yeah, I think there was a long, fruitful interplay between Hong Kong and mainland China for many years. Many of these works of counter history, of underground history, were published first in Hong Kong. Later then circulated online. This is the best practices. I'm not sure. I guess mostly the best practices is just to keep a backup of stuff when you're doing research. I don't think there's maybe that kind of level of work. I know when the national security law was passed in 2020 in Hong Kong, I have a little vignette on this in the book. One of the publishers in Hong Kong, Baopu, who runs the 21st Century Press, he contacted me and said the warehouse owners are all scared now because they hold all these books, even though you can't see, because we know that, like, a lot of these bookstores, you probably read in the newspaper, a lot of these bookstores were closed down in previous years, but the warehouses were still full of all these books. And so they weren't really sure now, what do we do with these books? So several entrepreneurs from Hong Kong donated money just to pay to have the books sent abroad. So they were sent, so I got hundreds of these books, and I sent sets of them to other, to research libraries, just to try to, you know, find a home for them. And I selfishly kept one set for myself. But so I think that's kind of the extent of it. It's been a loss, for sure, because this was a place for people on the mainland to go. The university's service center at CUHK was a place initially where foreign scholars would go to gather information and knowledge about China before China was opened. And then it became a place for Chinese scholars going to Hong Kong to get information. And the loss of that center has been a big blow to that movement. Interestingly, I mean, this is a bit off the topic, I thought a lot of this might go to Taiwan, but I found that that's not really the case, that some people do go to Taiwan as visiting scholars, make trips there. But Taiwan, overall, and I'm overgeneralizing here, I don't mean to offend anybody from Taiwan, but it seems like it's overall caught up in its own identity issues. What are we? Are we part of China or not? And that there's not as much attention paid. Like the Taiwan government has not given visas to people from Hong Kong. You know, I think they might want to have just given 10,000 visas. It's funny, you know, an island that has a demographic crisis right now that's basically where its population is falling, et cetera, just like Japan's and now China's, that they would open it up to people from Hong Kong, but they haven't. Even the famous, or infamous, depending on your point of view, media mogul Jimmy Lai from Apple Daily, he tried to get a permanent residency in Taiwan. They say, well, we have enough media entrepreneurs, we don't need you. And he's like, this guy's like got hundreds of millions of dollars, you know? you don't want to give him a visa? But they weren't interested in it. So it's a kind of a weird dynamic. I think there's a lot more going on in other cities around the world. I know there's a lot, I just know the scene in New York, there's interesting salons there, discussion salons. I was in Harvard and there's interesting salons. There's probably stuff in Washington also that I'm just not aware of. And there seems to be much more going on in other countries, probably also in Japan and Korea. I just don't know. I know for sure also in Berlin, London.
You had a question?
Stanley Coburn, Georgetown alum. First, a point of information. Spark was also the name of Lenin's newspaper. So I'm not sure if that's where, in 1960, they got it. One exception, there's so many Chinese students here, if you're talking about the history. 300,000 here, 300,000 in other countries. We've never seen this before anywhere. And they study the history. I remember one of the, you're nodding, and they take it back. I remember one of the Georgetown law students saying, we'll take these values back to China. So you've, on the one hand, you have this control. But on the other hand, if it's such total control, why does the Chinese government allow all these students to come over here, take all these courses and so on?
Yeah, that's a good question. To answer your question, it's interesting you mentioned that. A couple of people have asked me. The name was taken, according to the people, the memoirs, from an idiomatic expression in China called a single spark can start a prairie fire. So they didn't mention Lenin's, the magazine, but it could have been perhaps in the back of their mind also something. And Mao had used this expression a lot also in several of his essays. So that's where they got it. Why the government allows people to study abroad, hey, I don't know. Maybe some of the Chinese students want to answer that question. I think they're probably thinking that most people are going to study engineering and stuff like that and go back and contribute to building the country. There's also this has got its own dynamic now, people going abroad to study. I think forbidding middle-class families from sending their kids abroad to study would probably create a big backlash, I'm guessing. And that also, if you're studying all this sensitive stuff, when you go back, you may not be able to publish it or make use of it. So therefore, you may have that personal knowledge, but whether you're then impacting the situation in China is questionable. And from the party's point of view, that's okay. So you may know this, but if you're not affecting other people, then it's okay. I don't know. I'm not really an expert on return students and stuff like that.
So the most prominent incident is probably a memory anecdote recorded in social media in China. It might be just a screenshot, it might be a video, it might be a tweet on Weibo. I'm curious how would a future historian in 10 years, let's say, they want to study the zero COVID period, how would they treat this kind of source of information?
Oh, yeah, such an interesting question. When I reported on Falun Gong 20-odd years ago, there were all these interesting websites and blogs and articles, and they've all disappeared, of course, as you can imagine, as things move on and people don't pay for their blogspot subscription or something like that. But the main thing, what I do now is I have on my browser, I have an extension from the Internet Archive. So that's sometimes known as the Wayback Machine. It's www.archive.org. They have a browser extension which looks like a little house or a bank or something like that. And when you're on any site, you can just click on that and it will do, it'll archive this site. So even if later it's erased, you can still find an archive version of it there. As long as that institution exists, maybe in 20 or 30 years from now, it won't exist and it'll all be lost. I mean, another thing, so I think you have to use those things, you have to be careful when using them, of course. In fact, for almost all URLs that I cite in my book, I have a bibliography and a lot of footnotes and stuff like that. I use archive.org, in other words, in archived footnotes, URLs, because these things evaporate very quickly. Sometimes it's nothing nefarious. Sometimes it's just that you find it often with universities. Like a talk will go up on a site and then later it'll migrate to another thing and the URL has changed. And the URL that you had before is dead after like a month or two. And so you have to archive those things if you're using them. And I think cite from the archive things. I think that should be best practice. In fact, I think it should not be allowed just to use, like, so for WeChat or Weixin, right, you can archive those. So it's www.weixin.com.cn/blah, blah, blah, whatever it is, right? But you can archive those things and you can find them then later. And so then if you go to the site and to the link and it's dead, you can see on your browser extension that an archive version exists. And so then you can go there. So if it's a very well-known site, they're trawling that all the time. So they'd be trawling like the Georgetown University site all the time and archiving pages. But if it's not well-known, like somebody just puts up a post about COVID or something like that, some essay or their diaries or something like that, if you see that and you're interested in it, you should really archive that as quickly as possible, because those things could disappear very quickly. And as you say, then they're repackaged and they're turned into image files like JPEGs and then sent like that. So there's a lot of that stuff. But in terms of trying to use it as an academic or somebody writing on it, then you have to, I think, archive it.
Yes.
So you mentioned you started this work like 10 years ago, and I was just wondering, maybe you touched on this a bit, but what changes have you kind of noticed among the people doing this kind of archival work? And, you know, have they changed? How has the work changed? You know, and obviously a lot has happened in the last 10 years in China. So what has this sort of evolution looked like just since you've been looking at them?
The scope for action has narrowed for some people. Certainly their ability to access in even limited ways the general public. There used to be independent documentary film festivals in China, in Beijing. I mean, they weren't huge things, but they did exist. So some of these films could be shown there. And sometimes there was a bit more space for things being published, for discussions. That's narrowed. Some of the more famous people involved, like Ai Xiaoming, who I mentioned, I mean, she's a well-known figure, I think. She was just told last year that she would not be allowed to leave China until the year 2032. So for her, it's sort of like it's a harder time to leave. The filmmaker Hu Jie, who's made about a dozen films, including three absolutely classic documentary films, in my opinion, I'm not a film critic or historian, but he's sometimes harassed where he'll go, say he's gonna drive to go interview somebody. He drives for 4 hours, gets there, knocks on the door, and then the person says, it's not convenient for me to talk. Sorry, closes the door in his face. And clearly somebody's called him up, right? And he had just arranged with the guy ahead of time to talk, and all of a sudden it's not convenient. So they get harassed like that. I think that's true of the better known people. And that's generally the government's MO, right? They can harass. This is where I maybe differ slightly from the people who have this dystopian Orwellian surveillance state view that that's all that exists in China. I think they can harass or control some of the people all the time, all the people some of the time, but not all the people all the time. And so there are people who are still active and still doing things, even if they don't have platforms. I think at certain times they can crack down on people, and once you get to be bigger and bigger, then the government will pay more and more attention to you. But it's always been kind of the case in critics.
I think we have time for a few more questions. Yep.
Okay. I was just wondering if through your work you've come across any underground historians doing work on the history of ethnic minorities in China. In particular, I worked as a research assistant for a group that's translating ethnic Koreans in Yanbian, like journal short stories written during the Mao era. And it was really hard to find history about them or their publications. So I just wondered if you had experience with historians working on that.
Yeah, that's something that perplexed me when I was writing the book and doing research, that there's so little information in the minority areas, that as bad as things were, say, in the Cultural Revolution, in Han areas of China, if you go to places like Tibet, it was much worse, not only in the physical destruction, which you can see from the destroyed temples and so on, but the lack of data, that somebody like Yang Jisheng could go to archives in the 1990s and 2000s and find information on the famine was possible in Han areas. I don't think that was ever possible in Tibetan or Uyghur or other areas, because it's always been treated more carefully. So that's why some people talk about post-memory as a way to think about those places, that you're dealing with, you're not dealing with the documents and even oral history witnesses. You're almost dealing with trauma, inherited trauma, and issues like that. I have a chapter on the extremities of China, and I look there at the Tibetan poet and essayist Woser, Tsering Woser. She published a book that was really, really interesting about her father's photographs. Her father was an official photographer with the PLA. He was ethnic, he was Tibetan, and he worked for the PLA in Tibet. And he kept all of these photos and annotated them extremely carefully. And she remembers, as an old man, he was going through these photos all the time, annotating. And then he died and he left them all to her. And she wasn't really sure what to do with them. And, you know, she thought he was just an amateur photographer, like maybe beautiful pictures of the Potala Palace or something like that. She held up and they were all pictures of destruction of the in Tibet. And very clearly annotated the date, the location. And so through those photos, and this is a trove of photos that really doesn't exist, because also we have photos of many famous photos of people being struggled against in the Cultural Revolution, other photographers, but almost nothing from Tibet. And it's probably true in these areas that you're studying also. So this was useful just for creating historical knowledge that, aha, that's when that temple was destroyed on exactly that date. We now have a photographic record of it. And she published this as a book called Forbidden Memories in Taiwan, and then she and Robbie Barnett, the Tibetologist, they published an English language version with new annotations. And she did a lot of oral history work also. She went back to the places, she talked to people who were shown in the photos and got, or who were still alive obviously, or their children, and found out what had happened to them. So that's possible, but it was just a fluke, right, that she happened to get this.
I think we have time for one more question, maybe? Two more questions?
Yeah. Hi. One of the things that's intriguing about your description of what's the period that you've just studied, the last 10 or 12 years, that goes back, you know, in my experience earlier in China, is the liberating effects of technological change, but also the ability or the willingness of the party to try and stifle it. So I remember, for example, in the aftermath of Tiananmen, people began sending faxes because almost everybody had a fax machine back then. And you could get a list of fax numbers in China and just send these one-page Chinese language documents to people who were, you know, anonymous, who didn't know where they were. But it was carrying the news from the outside of China to inside China, what was actually happening after June 4th. And I worked as a translator for an American Bar Association delegation that went in 1991 to China. And we met with the wife of Wang Juntao, Hou Xiaotian, who had written a 45-page defense of her husband. And she gave it to us to get outside of China and subsequently published and translated into English. But she said, you know, if you want to get in touch with me now, you can use my BPG. And I was like, BPG? What's a BPG? And I was trying to think of a Chinese for BPG. And so finally she pulled out her beeper and said, this is BPG. And it seemed like, you know, the jig was up if, you know, anyone who had a beeper could be contacted from outside of China until they figured out ways to censor that.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. This is why I'm cautious. I don't think that the way to look at this movement that I'm describing is some sort of a movement that's about to topple the party. And I don't focus on things like social media so much, because I think social media is often a straw fire. You get some big brouhaha, but then there's no foundation to it. And what interests me is that there's a lot of the people involved in this, they're networked in a way. They all kind of know each other, and there are, it's much wider spread than I think existed before. And so I think that the technology thing is difficult, but I think that the basic digital technologies help a lot. Even something I didn't mention is digital cameras, which we now totally take for granted, right, in our mobile phones. If you think of how difficult it was to make a film 30 years ago, you needed to have a giant camera and a tripod and all this stuff, and you even pre-digital, you had to take the camera, it had to be developed somewhere where somebody could see what you're doing. You had to cut it in a studio where people could see what you're doing. It was only the state had this kind of equipment, especially in a place like China. Now you can take a little camera that has image stabilization software, it makes great film, you can cut it on your laptop, and you can, without anybody really knowing what you're doing, unless they're seeing you filming, you can make this film. And there's very ambitious films being made. Ai Xiaoming, I mentioned, I mean, she's an amateur student of film history. She watched Showa, the works of Klaus Landsman, Hotel Terminus. And she watched all these films, and she made a really long film on the Jabiangou labor camp. And she did it all herself. She didn't take any foreign funding because she didn't want to be accused of taking foreign funding. She didn't have any money. She just traveled up to Gansu on her own with a volunteer research assistant, and they did it all themselves and cut it. I mean, I can't say that this is on a level of Klaus Landsman. Maybe it's not one of the greatest films of all time or something like that, but it's a really ambitious work that's trying to tell a really important story, and I think that that's only possible because of digital technology. Now, whether it has an audience, right, and has an impact, that's another question.
One more question, if anybody else has anything.
Maybe that's who.
I wanted to follow up. I can thought about your answer a little bit. So, I'm sorry. I wanted to follow up on your answer. I'm trying to, in Western history, we look for continuities and discontinuities to preceding cultural frameworks, going back to Greece or whatever, coming forward. Is there any of that kind of historical mindset, or again, is the party sort of pre-party is irrelevant, don't discuss it, don't think about it, we only live in the present and going forward? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, I have two thoughts on that. One is, the party doesn't think that everything pre-1949 is irrelevant. Chinese history is a source of pride for Chinese people, and they're great. If you go to the National Museum, so there's two permanent exhibitions. One is The Road to Rejuvenation. You go into the basement, and it's sort of like treasures of the Chinese past, where they have all the fantastic discoveries they have. Because as a central museum in China, they can vacuum up stuff from provincial museums. So they have the winged horse from Gansu. They have the flying horse from Gansu. They have terracotta soldiers, the best terracotta soldiers, and they have all this stuff. So that's seen as a way also to legitimize the party. But I think from the counter-historian's point of view, they see themselves as in the tradition of the great historians of the Chinese past, who were judge and jury of the dynasty. They see themselves as inspired by people like Sima Qian, who suffered greatly in order to write the grand history of China. And they know that in the end, history that right defeats might. At least that's sort of the lesson in a lot of these stories that kids learn, the historical lessons that you learn in Chinese history books, and that the historians are the good guys. It's not the person, the emperor who castrated Sima Qian was not the good guy, right? The good guy is Sima Qian, he's the hero of the story. And so they see themselves in that tradition as the underdogs who will ultimately prevail, and that they'll be the ones perhaps in the future who are studied, or at least carried on for another generation.
I think that's a wonderful note to end on. Thank you so much, Ian, for coming.